I'm back, sort of. I'm at the, what do you call this, end of the first quarter for the remote hunts. I was at I was midway up the province on the east side. I never ever say where I am when it comes to hunting, especially when I'm invited to go where I've never been before from avid keen guys that want to keep their hard work that they put into gaining their hunting spots. They want to keep their hard work safe and not get the place completely overrun with other hunters, right? Because that can ruin everything pretty quick. Anyway, so all I can say is I was halfway up the province of British Columbia and more to the east side of it, quite remote. And now I am in north central British Columbia, and I have to be here for a day. So I got a room, hotel room here. And then tomorrow I get the rest of my supplies, and then I head north for another 6 hours north drive. And then I'll be quite remote. And then from there, I leave the pavement and I will be going up some old gravel roads. And then I'm gonna load up my quad and I'm gonna take some old seismic lines to get to another place that I've spied on the map, and I'm going to find a very large bull moose on my own, and I'm gonna bring it home. So in the meantime, I have my old phone right here with me, which still has a pile of emails on it that were shared with me to share with you all. Excuse me. And it's about the only way I can do it without doing the regular filming at home with the camera, doing the edit program and stuff, because obviously I don't have a computer with the edit program, but I do have my new phone set up right here filming right now. And I'm now going to share as many of these emails as I can while I'm sitting here basically doing nothing. And there won't be any editing, so you're going to have to bear with me, because usually I'll chop out emails that absolutely turned into a bit of a waste of time, which happens time to time again, or sometimes I get lucky and every single email will be very worthy of sharing with all of you and very little editing and it's very smooth. So if it isn't smooth, you're going to have to go through the cringe parts with me and see if we can do it this way. So, I don't know how you would title this one, raw and unedited, here we go, all right? Okay, it's titled, "We just turned on the lights and bam, life changed." Hi Steve, love your channel and how you have brought so many point of no returners together in a safe place to share and ponder what the hell is going on. You are lighting the way so that people may see the truth of what is being hidden from us in the dark of our world by the so-called powers that be. You have compelled me to share. It's time. Super awesome news. Let's go. My story happened in 1978 when I was 15. It was early summer in a small town in northeast Missouri. My stepbrother, Rod, who was 16, his best bud, Russ, and I were in the truck driving Russ back to his home about 10 miles from town along the lake road. It's a pretty good sized lake. One side is neatly manicured and maintained like a park. The other side is densely forested with occasional nice expensive homes. That is the side where Russ's family lived. Along the way to the other side, Rod pulled off into a little narrow peninsula-like strip of land with water on both sides. It was a bare well mowed picnicking spot, or we could sneak a cigarette while we were out. So lame, I know, but we were teenagers who had just gotten the newfound freedom a driver's license offered. The truck was stopped, facing the lake shore about 30 feet back from the water's edge. We turned off the engine, but stayed inside with the windows down and were listening to the radio and talking and laughing. It quickly became quiet, dark, and we knew had to get Russ home before he got into serious trouble, being out past dark. As Rod started up the truck and turned on the headlamps, to our surprise, we discovered that someone else had entered the peninsula on foot and had walked right past us without our noticing. They were right in front of us at the water's edge, crouched down back towards us with one hand in the water. They didn't seem to react to us starting the truck and turning our lights on them. So Rod turns on the high beams to get a better look at this person when it stands up and briefly turns to look towards us. At that moment, to our shock, we all realized that this was definitely no man. The face was not human, more ape-like. It was a huge, very tall, dark brown beast covered with scruffy hair. Definitely not someone in a suit. You could see the muscles in the skin, and there were no trees or even a stick or for it to hide behind. It just completely out in the open, and we got a very good look. Too good. There was no room for doubt. We were looking at each other in total disbelief, saying, "What in the F is that thing?" We just kind of sat there dumbfounded for a few seconds as it just casually turned and started to walk out away from us like we were annoying it. At that moment, Rod jolted and slammed the truck in reverse, and we hightailed it back to the main road as fast as we could go. The poor truck took a beating. We didn't know what to think or say, so we were just silent the rest of the way. As we dropped Russ off, we agreed we shouldn't tell anyone because they would only think we were making it up, nuts or drug heads. Definitely nothing good would come of it. That's unfortunate, isn't it? Isn't that unfortunate how many people think that way? We did not come back the next day to check for prints. There was no reason. We knew what we saw. There was nothing to confirm. We never discussed it between ourselves ever again. For many years, I just completely put it out of my mind. I had no lingering fear of it or the outdoors, even at night in the woods. I was married for 15 years, but never shared my experience. Lately, though, I thought about it again. As I look back, I realized that whatever it was seemed very peaceful. It meant us no harm. There was no evil in its eyes, as some people report. It seemed that really couldn't have cared less about us being there, other than our annoying headlights. It obviously had no fear of us. I mean, it approached us as it hadn't been there when we pulled up, at least not visibly. Maybe it wanted to be seen, who knows? So I finally told my adult daughter about my experience about a week ago, per what you suggested. I figured I owed her the truth. She said she really didn't believe in all that stuff. I told her that was nice. Unfortunately, it wasn't afforded that choice. Keep up the good work and sharing the people's stories. The truth is out now, as it should be. NL. And how correct you are, the truth is out, as it should be. It's just too bad we didn't have the real big truths out, right? The big ones, like, why are we being lied to, misled? It's very frustrating for me and many other people. But we're getting to the bottom of it. And I'll tell you what, I am excited to read every single news story that gets sent in. Because it's more people, it makes all of our power stronger, and it's more knowledge. Thank you so much for sending that in. And if you come across any more knowledge that you think that people could benefit from you, send it to me. I'll get it to everybody, all right? What happened to Roger Rabbit? All right, who knows what it's going to be like, you guys, but here we go, raw and unedited. Hi, Steve, what a great idea. I've been following you for about a year. And to see if someone has the nads to really break into the subject. The tell-all about anything format is changing the way we think, or at least some of us. I'm still trying to work up the nerve to share my story, as it has so many twisted turns. For now, an intro and a question. I don't even know if I'm supposed to say your name, and because I can't edit, I'm not going to say it. Maybe at the end. My name is blank blank. I was born in Soldotna, Alaska, about a half mile from the Kenai River. I grew up on a homestead. My nearest friend Vince lived over 2 miles away. Hard to believe I'm now pushing 60. Nobody I know would have guessed I'd make it this far. I was informed at my father's funeral he had taken out two different life insurance policies on me. The first when I was 5. He doubled down when I was 15. My snowmobile racing years. I'm surprised he didn't triple down when he put me in an 83 Kenworth, maybe the youngest line driver around running the Dalton Highway between Fairbanks and Dead Horse, Alaska, Purdue Bay. I'm not trying to brag, these are just facts. I grew up during the pipeline boom years. My dad was a cat skinner pioneering roads for the ARCO and Marathon. He would be gone for months. Other than mom and three older sisters, my dog Tuffy, the closest house to ours, was a good half mile off. Mom started drinking. I suppose she was lonesome. She was half Cree, half French, from Faust, Alberta. Grew up on Queen Charlotte and then Kodiak Island when she was still little. Holy cow, she's seen some cool places. When my sister's boyfriends came back from Vietnam, our home became super dysfunctional. I wasn't into weed and partying or drinking or any of the weird stuff happening in the house. So Vince and I built a fort in the woods, about 1,000 yards out into the forest, off the back of our remote homestead, back porch. We used to be gifted snowshoe hares. Question. You mentioned my friend 4 days ago. I started following him, sent him a message, and it turns out he was stationed at Fort Rich, or Elmendorf, when he was a Marine. This man had the balls to join up right after the Tet Offensive. The dude is brilliant. Has the proof to back up his words. DNA evidence. Academia has done everything they can to ignore his work, including your post from 4 days ago. Roger Spur is onto something real tangible research. His theories have merit, backed by science and the Holy Bible. Before I share my stuff, I need to know why Roger Spur and his mud fossil research was kicked to the curb. Off your channel of facts. I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about, to be honest. Kicked to the curb off your channel. I don't know how. I don't think we've kicked stuff off the channel. The fact is, you just advertently lined up with them. Doesn't feel right, brother. Give Roger his due, and thanks for helping so many others. If you need to grasp his research, you can. The Oregon coast has enormous mud fossils. Check out Tyson's Mud Fossil Adventures. Brace yourself, brother. Good luck. God bless. Stand tall. John Richard. You pride opened my mind. All right. Thanks for that email, I guess. I'm not quite, I'm a little confused. That was sent May 2nd, 2021. I'm going back in time in this folder. I don't know what you talked about, man, about kicking somebody to the curb off this channel. I really don't, but there you go. Another email read. And if we were editing right now, so you guys understand, I probably wouldn't have shared that email because it didn't offer up, somebody didn't have to get something off their chest, and it wasn't, and as well, it wasn't an experience to be shared with all of you where you could pull knowledge from it. So I probably wouldn't have shared that if I had the editing program here right now, just so you know, and that's so you can see how I work, how I do this. But we got it out there. Maybe we'll get some kind of reply. And maybe there's something in there for somebody. Who knows? There's another one. From my deceased mother. Steve, I'm so glad that you don't take no crap from anyone and give a lot of people a safe place to share what they have experienced. To have that feeling that someone is in the corner and believes them is just what they need for the most part. Now on to it. Excuse me. My name is Amber, and I'm a member of a federally recognized tribe. Growing up, we had to supplement our daily meals by hunting and gathering. I found that I didn't mind hunting, and I was a pretty good shot. Growing up, my mom wasn't around much due to working, so we were with my gram. One summer, my great aunts Doris and Lila came and asked for help in picking blueberries. My gram allowed me and my cousin to go with the aunties. Me and my cousin were about 5 years old at this time. Most would go and pick berries up on Mission Hill at a place we called the Plains. I was told not to eat more than I picked and given an ice cream bucket to fill with the blueberries. Now I have been a bit different all my life. Animals have always liked me, known things before it happened, or known things such as sickness about people. However, I don't know how to control it, or when it should show up, or about who. All of a sudden I felt something different and stood up and looked around. Auntie Lila asked what was wrong, to which I responded, "I'm gonna look for berries over there." To which she replied, "Don't go far and stay in sight." I rounded a down tree when I saw him squatting near the roots of the tree. His face seemed to show surprise. As I walked up to it, I held out my bucket. It actually reached in and grabbed the berries. I grabbed its hand and held it, poked it, and talked to him. Not with lips, though. It seemed to purr or coo, but I remember it having me remember where I lived, to try to remember in reverse from where we were. I then heard my aunties calling for me, so I ran over to them. They wanted my bucket, to which I said that I gave it to the hairy man. Auntie Lila was from the White Earth Reservation, so she understands hairy man concepts. She went over to where I was and hurriedly came back and then rushed us into the car. I don't remember picking berries after this, but what I do remember is a fence going up that I couldn't go anywhere. I couldn't go into the woods anymore. It went from being running through the trees to fearing them. 30 plus years later, I'm talking to my mom, who was fighting cancer, watching your show. She says I should write to you. I said, what? I told her what I remembered when she blew me away. She said that what I remembered wasn't just a dream, that Auntie Lila went into the house that day she took us picking berries and said that she saw it walking away with the bucket. Not only that, that it had shown up at the house outside the fence. My mom is gone now. She passed 8/8/21. So I decided to take her advice and write. Maybe this will urge others to write or feel that they're not crazy or alone. Thank you again, Steve Amber. Amber, absolutely sorry to hear your mom died. First off. And I'm very excited that you, happy that she urged you to share your experience with the world through me and that you did. And I'm sure she's probably sitting there listening to us right now. I would absolutely be certain of it myself. And that's an interesting story. Lucky you didn't go missing. I'm not saying that Sasquatch or the beings make children go missing, but you know as well as I do, most indigenous tribes, communities, probably 100% of them have always kept the children and the women indoors, locked up basically when the Sasquatch beings are around the communities. And that's not a secret, right? That's so common, it's ridiculous. But anyway, Amber, take care of yourself. I really appreciate you sending that in. I'm sure many other people do too, as well as your mother. Interesting share, man. All right, what else do we got? There's something with a familiar photograph. Hopefully I'll be able to add, hope I don't get too many photographs. If I only get this one photograph, I'll use it for the thumbnail in the video, right? Now, please read Share Online. Steve, I'm the war vet wounded twice from Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. You've never read my story? I think more military would come forward from telling my story sent four times starting 2 years ago. You've mentioned it with the chicken coop guy missing 10 chickens. And then yes, there were 17 to 20 of us that interacted with this hairy man, and several of us said they see my story. Several have said that they see my story, they'll write down their own testimony. They watch your channel too. And yes, three of us saw it through the CCTV and others with their eyes and other technologies that I can't talk about. If you have questions, Steve, you have my email address. Ask away. Saw the creature up close and personal. You could say that it wanted to hurt us. I'll never forget that roar, or especially eyes piercing into my soul, the only way to describe. Have PTSD from the incident and being wounded, but I know that the encounter with the hairy thing has been worse. Oh, hold on a minute. Have PTSD from the incident and being wounded, but I know that the encounter with the hairy thing has been worse. I've had several encounters with these beings after that event, like I have a bullseye on me from that night, December 2012. If you can't find or remember my story, let me know and I'll rewrite it again. It's long but extremely important knowledge that might add pieces to the puzzle. Mike T, Kansas City. All right, and then there's another one. Oh, so I guess I found it, thankfully. And it's attached right here below. So here we go. Hey Steve, I'm an ex-combat vet, served 5 tours in Iraq and Afghanistan, been wounded twice. Was in almost 14 years. When I came home back in 2011, I was stationed at Fort Leavenworth. One night in January 2012, was on guard detail at a medium-sized perimeter station, concrete walls, 2 feet thick, and solid steel blast door, a foot thick, just about a half mile from the Missouri River. My comrade stepped out to smoke. This is around midnight. And in a snowstorm, he started banging on the door within a minute of being outside. I opened the door and like, what the F, you just went out there. He's like, there's something out here and it's not a man. It's not any animal he's ever heard. It's screaming at him, but he couldn't see it. So I stepped out with him. We could hear something very big just into the woods about 100 feet away. Then we heard a scream roar. What the F ever. We both went back inside and locked the door. Within minutes, the thing started banging on the door with such force. It took me back to combat readiness in a flash. We looked at each other and the monitors in the station and we could see only the top of its head. Long story short, we finally opened the door after it took off and found dents in the solid metal. Mind you, yeah, still freaks me out. And footprints in the snow 21 inches long that led over the perimeter fence, which is 15 feet high, with razor wire, and the prints were headed towards the river. I'm a very rational person, don't take shit. Keep to myself, but had to share this. However, oh, never told anyone except my comrade who was on duty with me that night. It changed both of us to this day. Thanks for all you do, brother. Keep posting this stuff. We need to know what the F we're dealing with. You can use my first name, Michael. Thanks again for a release with no shame that night. Will always be with me, just like being wounded has. Michael. And then here is, excuse me, a photograph, and I will use this as a thumbnail. Oh, hopefully I got to get it from this phone or the other phone. Steve, I found this last April, mushroom hunting in a tree. No bears or a cougar. There's tree structures everywhere in these woods. I'm 2 miles south of the Missouri River, Kansas side, just outside Kansas City. Turkey hunted near there, man. And that picture is a mature buck hanging from its head way up a tree. It's kind of weird, eh? You know, we've seen that how many times now? Is when we've seen the carcass of an animal, a deer, whatever, hanging way up in a tree. And no, cougars don't do that. They bury them. And as well as bears. Black bears bury their stuff on the ground. Seen it firsthand numerous times. And I was actually just with some lifelong cougar houndsmen. And if you're not familiar with that, those are men that have hunting hounds and they run down big cats. And they've done it for years. And the cougars always bury their kill. So what hangs a mature white-tailed deer? A buck like that, prime, probably be 250 pounds. Kansas has big deer. Might even be pushing closer to 3. So what does that? I don't know. Somebody in BC, a hunter, posted on a hunting social media page a picture of a cow. I think it was a calf. And it was perfectly balanced on a branchless pole. So a tree has been snapped off. And that thing, it looked to be 12 to 14 feet off the ground. I don't know what that means. I don't know why they put things in the trees. If it is the beings that are doing it, I haven't a clue because I wasn't there. I didn't see them do it, right? But we can eliminate all the natural animals that we know of that would not do that. And it's interesting. But anyway, Mike, this was sent September 18th, 2021, or else that's when I saved it. Oh no, it was sent May 2nd, 2021. I saved it in here. Oh no, this is today when I'm reading it. Hello. Okay, man, if you got more, Mike, send it away, right? I probably would have read this out a lot sooner had I not bought a new phone. But I had you copied down in the folder ready to go, right? But you got more knowledge for the people to share through me that you feel would help, please do. And know, let it be known that we absolutely appreciate the time you took to send that in. And you're not the only one that's had that similar experience. Speaking of those CCTV screens, I cracked open the Proton email yesterday, first time in months, and Edgar is on there. He emailed me, and Edgar's alive, and he's still fighting the battle. He said that they just did a bone marrow transplant, a second one or third one, and it finally took. He promised to send me, man. Edgar, I know you're listening, man. I emailed you back twice yesterday. And you said that you had attached an email from one of your scientist colleagues for me to share with everybody, but it wasn't attached. Oh, but anyways, get back to all you guys. I'm just letting you know that Edgar's alive. He's fighting. He's not feeling well. And that's stopped him from sending us his transcripts from his life career, which he was going to do. And you know what, Edgar, if you do, you do. It'd be absolutely appreciated. If you don't, you don't. All right? Hopefully you prioritize your time to you and your family and your battle. Okay? And don't worry about us. And if we do get our hands in that history that you accumulated, that'd be probably fantastic. And if we don't, that's fine as well. Okay? So don't beat yourself up about it. All right? Just make sure you win this fight and stick around with us for a lot longer time. And don't forget, 90% of that battle is between your ears. You don't give up. Okay, Edgar? Don't give up, period. And thanks for those emails, man. Get back to all you guys. There you go. Edgar's alive. He's well. He could use your prayers and your well thoughts to encourage him to fight this shit off and live some more life with his family. Okay. That picture. I can't. Uh-oh. Where'd it go? All right. Oh, here it is. I found it. Thank God. See, this is what you got to go through when I can't edit. You're going to have to hang out with me while I do all this. I don't know how I'm going to share this. Maybe I can text it to myself. I'll try it. And then... actually, shit. I'll remember to do this. I'm going to have to go back to reading. This is going to take too much time. I'll do this after I get the camera shut off, all right? All right, get back down to the bottom of the list here. Find more people that need to be heard. All right, what's this one? Mark it as red. Indiana, with a question mark. Hi, Steve. I live in and grown up in a small rural area in northeast Indiana. This happened many years ago when I was a teenager, in the mid to late 70s. It was on August evening. I was cruising into town one Friday night in my 67 Dodge Dart convertible with an 8-track cranked up to meet with three of my buddies to go out for the night. As I made a left-hand turn, there was a 20-acre woods on my left. As I turned and sped up, I seen a shadow coming across the fence. It stepped into the bottom of the ditch, and the next step was on the side of the road. Approximately 6 to 8 feet. By now, I had my foot stick through the floorboard on the gas. It never broke its stride. The next step was in the center of the road. I swerved to the right, just missing it. I looked in the mirror, and it was across the road. When I got to my buddies, I put my top up and said I wasn't going anywhere because I didn't feel like it. My one buddy knew something was wrong and asked. I said nothing. A couple months later, he was playing cards and got to talking about Bigfoot. That's when I said I'd seen one. Two of my buddies laughed and said I've had too much to drink. The other one said, I believe you because I seen one also. He told me when, and it was around the same time I seen it. He seen it plowing through the field about a quarter from his house one night. He said when we got to the end, it turned. He said when he got the end to turn it. Was to turn, it was walking in the bottom of the creek, which was dry at the time. Him and I used to study together sometimes, and his folks is like second parents to me. His mom asked what was bothering him. I said, what do you mean? She said, something has him scared. He never goes out to the barn or anything after dark. He sleeps with the shotgun loaded beside his bed. So I made her promise not to say anything, and then I told her the stories. She said, I have lived in this house all my life. In the big woods across the field, half a mile, used to hear all kinds of sounds. And she never used to go out at night also. It was October and it was our first snow just starting. I went out to my car to get warm. There's maybe a half an inch on the ground. I ran out, jumped in, started it. And when I got out, I noticed footprints. I grabbed my light and started looking. Just prints, no real definition, just prints. It was really big. I stepped in one with my shoes and they were at least 4 inches longer than my shoes. And I wear 11 and a half. I went back in and said goodbyes. And I told them to lock your doors tonight. They never locked up. You didn't have to back then. And I told him why he yelled for their dog. And we heard him whimper from out the back porch. He was shaking like a leaf in a storm and also lost control of himself. When we opened the door to go back into the house, Bear, his name was, ran into the laundry room in a corner and continued to shake. He would not move. This dog would kill coyotes and bring them home. I went to my car and went home, and when I got there, I was called and let them know I was home. That was the last time anything like that happened, but I lived in a woods of about 40 acres, and sometimes it was unnervingly quiet at night. You could not sleep. And the creek that ran past my house was also the same one he seen it. We lived about 4 miles apart. I've never told anyone the story except my oldest granddaughter, just so she will be more aware of the things around her. Thanks for what you do. God bless. Wow. You know what? I hope everybody starts talking more openly about these things and sharing with the kids. It's obvious why, right? It's obvious why. It's funny. I was hoping to do that live YouTube a few days ago, but I just didn't. Everybody's just so busy. And by the end of the day, by the time you get back to the cabin, you're just done, like dinner. Then we eat, and then everybody's just passing out. Not much energy left. But I was hoping to share some of the knowledge that another man, a friend of mine, who I was just with the past week, hunting elk, he's seen footprints, he smelled them. Altogether, he had a native guy, had seen one of these things coming off the property we were hunting. We had another couple last year who's seen what they described as a man in a ghillie suit basically vanish before their eyes in the swamp there. Excuse me, I just ate like just before I started this, excuse me. And what else? Yeah, so there's another couple had been roared at last year, but then they quickly changed their story to as a moose. And they also reported to seeing something like the predator being in the movie Predator, where they couldn't quite see it, but they could see something shimmering, moving and whipping through the edge of the swamp and the timber edge. And that all went down where I just was last week. But anyway, getting back to this previous email, this one, thank you so much for sharing that. I'm sorry it took so long to get it out and share it with the people, but it got out there, right? And they all will eventually. And it's amazing to me how many people manage to not speak of what they experience for years and not even share a family. It's still amazing to me. It always will be amazing to me. It saddens me in a way, and I hope that I am, and all the other people that share on this channel, are giving all of you people out there courage to just be honest and be honest with your neighbor and be honest with yourself and get that information out, because it's important. There's literally hundreds of thousands of people now know that all of you are not crazy and that all of you haven't made the shit up. And they know now without a doubt that we're sharing the honest to God truth with the world. And we're not scared to anymore, right? So keep them coming in. But anyway, what do I do now? I got to make a list of all the gear I need. And I am going to do a live podcast with a popular hunting store during this trip. I'm not sure when, but I will do it. And I'll let you guys know when. I'd rarely ever do that for anyone. But these guys are where I live. And they represent the outdoors that I also represent and partake in. And I'm gonna go sit down and have a live conversation. I don't even know what they wanna talk about yet. Who knows, it'll be interesting, right? I'd imagine this topic may come up. I don't know if they've done their homework and know about this channel or not, but we're gonna find out, aren't we? Either way, I'll let you guys know what I possibly might do when I get in there. They set up their own camera and they do it for their own channel. What they do is they close down the store and they have somebody come in. So I will, maybe I'll set up the phone here on the counter, do a live thing and record at the same time, or I'll throw my own camera up there and record it anyway. So there you go. Man, I'm beat. That was a long week of hiking and a lot of meat packing. A lot of elk meat came in last week, which is super duper. But anyway, share my story at howtohunt.com, tell my story at howtohunt.com. And if you have knowledge that the people need to hear, send it in. All right. If you have knowledge that the people need about anything, you get it to me. All right? Share the knowledge. Don't be scared of your neighbor anymore. Talk shortly.